All right, everybody, today on Breakdown, we are going to break down the song Shepherd of Fire here with Johnny Christ to bring his impeccable insight.
You know it.
So this song, we pretty much knew we wanted to start off the album, and we always like to have thematic, interesting intro songs where it feels like the opening of an album, but it also works within the context of the song. So this one we wanted to open up like we were in hell.
Yeah.
And spooky. So first thing we were trying to do was create a soundscape that would feel like all the typical things you'd think of in hell, like fire, the bells. We went through a lot of different sample libraries. We worked with a lot of different people. We weren't really happy with any of it. So we kind of just did this ourselves and put it all together. So let's break this down a little bit. The ominous undertones, what that is. Some wind.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Wind in hell, dry wind.
I don't know why we would put that in there, but sounded good.
We have two different types of bells here.
Just something you'd hear out of a horror movie or something like that.
And the timing's interesting here. You know, we let everything be on its own sort of time grid.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing's really on a... On a click or anything.
No, not at this not point. Any of this stuff, yeah.
And I guess the point of the two bells is just to kind of get a different tone than whatever the samples were, and also they're kind of off, which makes it kind of have like a reverb to it, which is cool. And then some big drums.
I think that's part of the theme of setting up the new the start of a record. It's like have everything kind of come in at itself, you know. The explosion there.
I mean, the drum tone on this record's huge. A lot of simplicity. You know, we heard a lot of people that wanted crazier drums, but on this record we were just going purely for girth.
Yeah. Well, just taste and openness. You hear all the classic records, right? Where you can't put too many fucking hits all the way through it. You need to let the drums breathe to even get a sonic bass like this.
So when we were writing this guitar riff, I remember Brian was coming up with a lot of stuff, and then the simpler it got, the more interesting it got to us. So
in this whole song and record, we're trying to like make sure that we brought everything back to being super tasteful and open, same as we were just talking about the drums.
So here we go. We have the intro guitar. And then we basically, because it's the beginning of the album, the drums have been introduced. The guitar has been introduced, and now we're just going to start adding in piece by piece.
Exactly.
So we have a Helwin here, a Dexter here, another Helwin, another Dexter. So four rhythm tracks going with this lead guitar on top of it.
It's a lot of guitar tracks.
Another guitar introduced. And then basically we're going to drop out this intro track, and then the rhythm guitars are going to take over. And so here we go. And the riff gets a little choppy, and the way to smooth that out is we just had you play one note, kind of driving the thing behind it.
Well, I remember we tried it a couple of times following that riff, and it didn't have the same effect.
Totally. So if you take just the bass and the drums here and you roll through it, you're going to see you are there specifically to drive the beat home.
Exactly.
Here comes the riff.
This is classic rock at its best right there. That's like kind of the idea, right?
You don't say so yourself. This is classic rock
this
at its
classic
best.
Rock, what I meant is the reference. But yeah, it's definitely, you know, when you hear classic bands do that, that's like kind of the reason why. It's just, like you said, it drives home the beat. It's taking what the drums are doing and the guitar and just melding them together a little bit.
Let's see if we can pull some of these vocals up.
There's a lot of fun stuff in here for sure.
A lot of shenanigans. So
we got to get into all those.
Okay, so we'll do some bass, drums, and vocals so we can kind of hear what's going on here.
No one has ever heard that before. It sounds so funny without the guitars to be.
So on this record, we wanted the one main vocal to have enough space so nothing was too cluttered, and we wanted it to be one vocal that can kind of stand on its own. That's kind of what you got here. It's very raw and organic, and it's one person singing one line at you with a couple guitars and the drums and just making it as simple and as rock as possible.
I got a storybook of my own. Don't you see I am your pride? Aging well,
there's a harmony there, but we're tucking it.
Yeah, most people aren't even going to hear that, really. Like, that was a cool moment, too, when we were writing this song, when you had that line and we just gave it that space. I remember going, oh, this is exactly what we need for the first song.
I remember I liked it a lot, but I was a little skeptical on people thinking that we were just trying to make another nightmare.
Yeah.
Because there's a stop and then you sing. Yeah, yeah. We try to never repeat ourselves.
It's so funny that you had that trepidation, because I remember for me, like when we were at your house writing this and it came up, I was just like, oh. I didn't think about Nightmare. I was just like, this is gold.
Yeah, it'd get a little weird like that. So so here's two of these lower vocals with the talking vocals, which again, if you've seen the stage, these are always easier to do as demos when you kind of wake up in the morning and do it, and then you have to go and do it for real, and you gotta like talk, and it's like, oh, it's stupid. It sounds stupid. Probably still sounds talking stupid, days. But it must be done. So here's the talking stuff. Let's see. Trying to stretch it as much as possible. Then we put a doubler on it. We did some effects on it to make it sound even more, you know, crazy.
What is that? That was pretty. That's pretty soft right there.
That doesn't sound very tough.
I gotta hear that one.
Let's hear that guy again.
I think that is the cleanest I think I've ever heard your voice.
Yeah, so tucked harmonies, pretty cool. Let's get into the guitar riff here. One of the things we were trying to do on this record was write one guitar riff and then stick with it. Mm-hmm. And then if it repeated, we're doing like little different iterations of the same guitar riff. And then as a verse passes or a chorus passes, then we go back to the full riff. So here we go. So you're going to hear this theme basically throughout the whole song.
Yeah.
I don't think it ever goes away.
No. Well, that was what's so painstaking about writing songs like this is that we wouldn't stop until like we all agreed that it was a solid enough riff to keep coming back.
The riff.
In the chorus.
Yep. I think what's cool about that is if you're able to sneak the riff of the song into the chorus, then there's no need to go back to the riff before the next verse. And so what we do here is we just go straight back into the second verse, and that's kind of what you get there, right back into the verse.
Yeah. Very uncharacteristic of us at this time.
So, and we have sort of a little secret on the chorus of this song, which is going to make us look like rather funny dudes. But
It's all the process.
It's part of the process. So we were working on the song, and we basically loved the way that Hail to the King turned out. We loved the chord we were using and stuff. So we started fucking around, and we started using the same chords on Hail to the King, but we put them backwards in it.
Yeah, reversed them.
So we reversed them. So here's the chords. So it's basically Hail to the King chords backwards.
Backwards, yeah.
And so we got together, we were having some drinks on Jimmy's birthday, and we weren't really writing, but we started fucking around.
Yeah.
And we started singing
Hail to the King over it.
Hail to the King, Hail to the King, Hail to the King over the chords that were backwards. And we said, well, we can't do that. That's fucking ridiculous. We're going to take our own chords.
On the same record?
On the same record. And it turned out to be song number one and two.
Yeah, exactly.
So basically the same chorus with reverse chords, singing Hail to the King over the Shepherd of Fire. And then we said, you know what? Jimmy would have loved that. He would have thought it's hilarious. So
we went with it.
We went with it. So if you take these choruses and you put them together and you kind of see, there's a lot of similarities going on there.
That's what you get from a couple of beers on Jimmy's birthday.
That's what you get. So if you think it's brilliant, you're welcome. And if you think it's fucking bullshit, then blame Jimmy.
Yep.
So, there you go.
I love that.
Now this talking part, let's bring up something embarrassing. All right, here we go. The embarrassing talking
disciple
with no effects.
Disciple of the cross and champion in suffering. Immerse yourself.
We had to make the studio really dark for you to do this part too.
We did, didn't we?
Pardon your mind from the chains of the divine. Make way the shepherd of fire.
Here we go.
Shepherd of fire.
That's so good.
The best part is
would you put that as your ringtone for a week?
Yeah, I would.
As your alarm? It'd be great.
It would be so good. But the best part about it, though, is you just got to get in the moment and be dead serious about recording that part right there.
It's sad. It's sad what it's become. And then I think we do a third chorus out. So this is just trying to add a little more, you know, depth to this last final chorus. And then it's another oldest trick in the book is you have some lead guitar over it, yeah. You know, making it a little more exciting.
Gotta have the bluesy part. What do we call that? Fat barbecue sauce?
That's what it's called. It's the name right there. Fat barbecue sauce. So here we go. Here we have outro guitar effects. So again, we're back in hell.
Yeah.
We're going out.
That's always the fun stuff to make too. Like when you're in the studio, yeah. You get to pull out all the pedals and go through everything.
So if you break down the ending, this is kind of what's going on. We turned a bunch of stuff backwards and we did a bunch of, you know, things to make it sound scary.
Yeah. Again, you're in hell. You're in a weird place. You're not going to hear everything the same way. So it's coming back that way.
And again, the bass is still driving this thing.
Yeah. It was the hardest part for me to record was right there.
Was it? You never know, man. Sometimes the easy things are hard. So all in all, it was a painstakingly simple song to write. It was definitely hearkening back to the old stuff, but it was something that really challenged us as songwriters on this record and this song in particular to really learn new techniques. Little things like that were really beneficial to our writing for when we moved on to the stage and moving on to the future. Just little tricks like that. So it's a cool song. It's got a lot of power, a lot of energy.
Yeah, it was cool to hear all this again, actually. I hadn't thought about it in a while.
That's it.
Hey.